you're very good, you know. Don't have to call you to attention, you're just there, which is wonderful. Okay, here are the notices. Here's the first one. We haven't had that for a bit, but just to say that this is what the Methodist Church have said, and I hope we will be living to the fulfillment of this, living wholeheartedly as followers of Jesus for the transformation of the world. And the transformation starts with each one of us, and then it goes on to the world. Anyway, let's move on to the next ones. Okay, these are the regular notices. Stephen speaking, and I'm doing the Elevate service. Hang around for that if you want to, because it'll be a good one. Okay, it won't be a good one then. these are the regular notices. David Lee hopefully will be taking the Tuesday Bible studies while Stephen is away. We'll move on to the next, please. Okay, that's the usual. The Friday morning prayer meeting, David Brady, he's not here yet, so I can't ask him, but I'll volunteer him. He'll be doing that in the mornings. If you wish to join him, talk to David Brady when he comes. Thank you. Okay, my latest video, if you haven't seen it, please do. It's a great one. Only 8 minutes. You should get something out of it. What it is finished. What's all that about? What did Jesus mean when he said it is finished? Then hopefully you'll be able to see that. Thank you. Okay, now, this is the churches in Ireland, in conjunction with Christian Aid, are putting on a seminar on the 21st of, April, this coming Friday. It's called Lost and Damaged Hope and Recovery. And it is in conversation with the Reverend Bob Kikuyu, who heads up the Christian Aid Head of Global Theology, and our very own Damien would be there as well and looking after the proceedings. We'd like as many people to join in to that, please, if possible, if you can make it on Friday. There is another leaflet here, which I will leave at the back, and Helen Shields here would be able to explain a bit more if you wish to find out a bit more about it. But anyway, it is on there. It's on our emails, if you get the emails, as to what it's about there as well. And then the following day, on the 22nd, is Earth Day, date for your diary. And again, I'll leave that leaflet at the back over there. You can have a look at them. Thank you. Wild Goose Chase, Pam Rooney talked about this. Again, you'll have to look at the emails because there's too much information to give out on that one. Let's go on. Okay, Stephen will be telling us a bit more about the sabbatical, so we'll leave that one. And then last one, I think there's one more. Are you okay? We'd like people to sign up for this, preparing meals, giving lifts, doing small DIY jobs, etc., with people within the congregation or wider beyond. If you are able to help, please do sign up or see Rose when she's here. Thank you, Stephen.
I feel a long, 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 long way away from you. I'm going to move forward a bit. Good morning and welcome. It's so good to see you all. And good, lovely, we've got a couple of folk here for the first time and a couple of folk returning after a long time. So it's wonderful to have you all with us. And we're all here as part of the family of God to worship God together. This is my last Sunday with you before I go away on sabbatical. I'll say a word or two about that just a little later in the service. But we're going to go straight into our call for worship this morning. Last week, being Easter Sunday, we spoke about the resurrection of Jesus, what it means to us, and what it meant in particular to some young folk who publicly confessed their faith in Christ and were received into the membership of our church. Today, I'm going to talk again about the resurrection of Jesus and the evidence for the resurrection of Jesus and how that played out in the life of one of the apostles, Thomas. But let us begin with our call to worship. Our call to worship today, I want to do it responsively. Now, I realize when we put this up this morning that one of the responses is almost illegible from where you're sitting, so I'm just going to power through that one myself. But I would like you to read the words on the screen, if you can, when I give you the nod. These are the words of Psalm 16, a psalm of great hope and encouragement for us. And it begins with these words, Lord, who may dwell in your... No, wrong one. Keep me safe, O God, for in you I take refuge. We say together, Lord, you alone are my portion and my cup. You make my lot secure. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have a delightful inheritance. I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night, my heart instructs me. And together we say, I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Our opening hymn this morning is one of the great resurrection hymns, The Day of Resurrection, Earth, Tell It Out Abroad. It's 311 in the hymn book. Seated, and let us pray together. Oh God, you are the author of life, the origin of life, the sustainer of life, the perfecter of life. You are the God of the resurrection. You are the God of the Easter morning. You are the God of the empty tomb, the God of the moved stone. You are the God of the garden where Mary met and heard her voice called. You are the God of the upper room where the disciples encountered you and received the Holy Spirit. You are the God of Pentecost when the church was filled with your power and your might. You are the God of the long walk who walks beside us and sustains us on our journey. You are the God of forgiveness. You are the God of hope. You are the God of comfort. You are the God of joy. You are the God of new beginnings. You are the God of everlasting hope and eternal life. Father, we gather this morning to worship you, to lift up our voices, to open our hearts, to expand our minds as we consider you. And we look to see what your word has to say to us about you. And Father, as we do so, the more we delve into your character, your personality, your mission, your creative power, we become so aware of our own frailties, our own weaknesses, our own failings. In a word, Lord, our own sin. But Lord, we are confident in spite of our sin, because you are the God who says that you will forgive us when we confess our sin to you. that you will renew us and restore us. And you will make us to be the righteousness of God, not by our efforts, but by your grace. So, Father, we confess to you this morning that our faith has often been cold. We have often harbored and nurtured doubts. We have often missed opportunities to be good witnesses for you. In so many ways, Lord, we have fallen short, and yet we know that as we confess to you, you forgive us our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So thank you, Lord, for your presence here with us and in us. Thank you for that cleansing forgiveness that is ours through Christ. Let us share together the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. I'm going to ask Rachel to come. She's just some really great news to share with us about something that's been happening. I'm not sure if she has a little helper. So that's okay. Crack on.
Good morning, everyone. Some of you that may have known or not is that last month there was a small group of us from Dundrum that went to a camp called Soulmates. And what Soulmates is it's a camp for, there's actually an image, if you want to put on, which I feel sums up our time there. It's a pretty awesome image. There we go. Look at that. Don't we look so cool? What Soulmates is, it's a camp for 9 to 13-year-olds held in Belfast, or not Belfast, it's held in Lurgan, which is the main question of the weekend. Is Lurgan in Belfast? No. It was held in Lurgan, and what it was one overnight between kind of three churches, and there was many groups from Belfast, from Northern Ireland and Republic of Ireland. There's two. There's ourselves and another group from Port Leash, I think, and myself and Andrew went as leaders and led a group of three young people from our church to this camp. And I think it's important that I stand up here and I share with you how that went, because it's important that we, you know, we support our young people as they journey through their own faith with God and kind of learning about him. So I just want to share a little bit about the camp and kind of what we did, and just so that you guys know. And it means that, you know, in the future you can, the young people themselves then can tell you about it as well, and you'll kind of know what they're talking about. So when we got there on the Friday night, we got through the Friday traffic, which was delightful, stopped off in our McDonald's, which was even more delightful, and then we went on to the church in Lurgan. And when we got there, there was... And we settled in with our bags and our sleeping bags and, you know, looked forward to that church floor sleeping experience, and which was, you know, when you wake up and you can feel your hips, it's probably not a good thing. But the young people were full on for it. We had our main stage event on the Friday night, and we had a guest speaker called Bob, and he's a fantastic, fantastic storyteller. Even as leaders, it was very hard not to be moved by the message that he was saying, and it was gathering at the banquet was his message. And his theme, invitation to the banquet, was his theme for the weekend. We also had a group called Play It By Ear. They're a company that do storytelling through drama, and they kind of like take on the characters of the Bible, but tell it through kind of a relative kind of modern day story to the young people. And you can imagine the engagement was fantastic for the young people to kind of witness this. We also had a great youth band that kind of led us in our worship event and our worship through the weekend. And then on Saturday morning, we got up, had our breakfast. We actually didn't have to get up until 8 a.m. for breakfast, but the kids were raring to go at 6:30. And I have two young kids at home, and I'm not even up that early at home. So they were full on ready to go. So we had our breakfast, and then we went straight into our main stage and our message for that morning. And actually, two of our young people were asked if they would like to lead the prayer for that morning, which they were 100% up for. And they led the whole, like there was about 120 young people all in all, and many, many leaders, many many stewards that helped put this camp together, and they, not a bother to them, were like, yes, I want to do this. So they led the morning service through prayer and prayed for our speaker for that morning. And then the afternoon we had activities. Thankfully, the weather was on our side as well. We had the nice sunshine, which we thanked God for, because it meant that we got to go to the park and do fun activities and games. But also we had activities that were a bit more, you know, Christian-led, in terms of we did a prayer walk. And myself and Andrew, I think, were a little bit, not nervous, but as in you don't want to, you know, pressure the kids into kind of saying prayers or things like that. You wanted them to kind of lead it. And as we were walking up the street and kind of down another street, there's two long streets, and we were walking, and, you know, it was dry and everything. But for like this 10-minute period, it rained. And we're like, oh no, this is going to kind of interrupt, you know, our kind of conversation and trying to talk about prayer. And me and Andrew were kind of praying kind of on and off. And at this point, a young person hadn't prayed yet. But then when it rained, we were like, oh, we'll get shelter for a few minutes and then we'll continue on with a walk. And I love moments like this, because I feel like in hindsight, you look back and you're like, that was just so meant to happen. It was meant to rain. Even though we didn't want it to, it was meant to rain. Because what that meant was, when we got shelter under a tunnel, we stood there. And I just, you know, introduced a few of the topics that we were given to kind of help us lead in prayer. And I started to pray. And with that, you know, two out of the three young people prayed out loud. And some of it may have been for their very first time, but they felt themselves that they wanted to do that. And I think that was a really lovely moment to mark and to notice. And I'm a little milestone for those. We went further into the evening then, and we had our main stage again. And the speaker, it was very reflective in terms of actually Christ's love for us and what Christ has done for us and given up his life, and kind of placing ourselves in Christ's body to imagine what that was like for him and for his perspective. And one of the things at the end, at the very end of the night, was there was a little prayer on our lanyards that we were given. And we, as leaders, then kind of got into our little small groups throughout this massive hall. And before the last worship session, if a young person would like to say this prayer, it was an important prayer, because this prayer meant that they were giving their life to God, and the significance behind that. And as leaders, myself and Andrew were praying with these young people and also kind of explaining what this prayer was, that if you say this, this is what this means. It's okay if you don't say it, but we want you to know what it means, so that if you do say it, you know that you are giving your life to God and how important that is and how lovely that is. And one of our young people really wanted to say this prayer. And myself and Andrew, I think there was, you know, a little bit of hiding emotions, because it was, you knew that it was real. You knew that God had really spoken to actually all three of the young people that we went with in different ways and in the ways that they need to be spoken to. And I just think it's important that, you know, I do get up here and I talk about camps like this, because there's real movement in our young people in this church. And it's not just in this church, but it stems back into this church and into our church community. So I just really encourage you guys to lift up those three young people in your prayers, and as they journey back into church and kind of seeing church in a different light when they return back, and kind of delve into kids' faith and to, you know, summer camps and things like that that we do hold in our church. So thank you for listening. I think we're going to do our kids' song. So this is our second last week of our kids' song, and then we're going to be changing it for the month of May. And I know that this kind of ties in with the theme of Stephen's message today. So at this stage, I definitely feel like we should know the actions. So I expect to see some actions in the back. If kids would like to come up to front to do the actions with me or in front of me, please, please do, so I'm not all alone. But no problem if you want to stay in your seats. So Andrew, if you wouldn't mind, thank you. That was a fantastic job. I don't even think you actually needed me up here. So fair play. Well done, children. That was brilliant. And the adults, you did well too. The children can head out now for Kids Faith and ARC. Discussion and discussion groups.
I just want to say a brief word about part of what we'll be doing on our sabbatical break. I say our because we're trying to do as much as we can, Linda and I together, over the next 3 months. I'm officially on sabbatical from Wednesday morning. I'm actually flying out to see my sister on Tuesday night, so that's sort of set a deadline for me. But the first thing I want to say is just how grateful I am that to have this opportunity, and that you as a church are prepared to release me for that time. I think there is a very strong biblical precedent for taking intentional, deliberate, and useful times of rest for recovery, recuperation, and just for rest. God rested on the seventh day, and within the Old Testament, there is talk about Sabbath day rests and Sabbath year rests. And the Jubilee is a Sabbath of Sabbaths. It's the 50th year after seven sevens. So it's writ through the Old Testament. And so it is something which the Methodist Church has embraced and encourages its ministers to do. And, you know, and I think as well, it's something I would encourage you to do whenever you can to be able to intentionally take times of rest, that you may be strengthened and encouraged. The key thing we're doing when we're away is taking a month in Africa. We fly to Johannesburg on the 12th of May. And while we're there, we're going to be spending some time with Paso a Paso. There's Francis that you'll recognize. Many of you will know him. And there's Ursula. And we have been asked while we're there if we would oversee the building of this, of a toilet block like this. It's not the most glamorous thing, but it's very important. And so that's one of the key things that I will be doing. Linda will be spending more time with the children and with the schooling part. And also they have a hospice service, which they help with as well. We're also visiting Pakamisa in Durban, and we'll be involved with their traveling school. It's coming up. They have teachers that travel out into the wandering teachers. That's the word. This wandering school that goes out into the local community to teach literacy and numeracy. So we're going to be spending a little time with them. We did have a coffee morning here some weeks ago, and money has continued to come in. People have been incredibly generous supporting these two projects, and everything we've received is being given directly to them. And I can tell you that as of this morning, we have raised €4,050, which will be divided, and it will fully pay for that toilet block. They reckon it'll cost about €1,500 to build that ablutions block. So we'll buy them some toilet paper as well. They can use the balance in whatever way they can. But we're very excited to be going. And I just wanted to give you a little flavor of what's happening while we're away. All the arrangements while we're gone, they're in the news sheet, so I'm not going to dwell on that. But the sabbatical committee will be Emma and Aaron and Andrew, who will kind of spearhead everything that goes on and field any awkward questions that you may have. So that's all I want to say about that. And once again, a very big thank you to you for releasing me for this opportunity. And I'm really looking forward to it.
Sorry, Stephen, before you go, can we pray for you and Linda?
Thank you.
Anyone else would like to come at the front and pray for Linda and Stephen? No, you're going to pray from there. Is that right? Okay. Well, I'll pray on your behalf. Is that okay?
Thank you.
Our Father, we want to thank you for this lovely couple of ours. And we pray for them now in Jesus' name. We ask for your presence to go with them as they travel and minister life. May life be given to them as well. We pray for your protection over their lives. We pray for the presence of the Holy Spirit, the wisdom of God, and the love of God just to be shed abroad upon their hearts. And as they give, may they receive. As they minister, may they be ministered to as well. And as they are traveling along, Father, may they be refreshed by your Holy Spirit. We commit them to you, and we ask again that you bless them as they bless others. And Lord, when they come back from this sabbatical rest, we look forward to a new enthusiasm, a new sense of direction, and a newness in their own spirits and hearts as they move us forward. So bless them, protect them, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, brother.
I'm going to invite Claire to come and bring our gospel reading for us this morning.
A reading from John chapter 20, verses 19 to 31. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that believing, by believing, you may have life in his name.
Thank you. Just a couple of verses from the first letter of Peter. From the opening chapter, 1 Peter chapter 1, from verse 3. "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you." And that's as far as I want to read there this morning. We're going to sing our next hymn, a song of commitment in thankfulness for what God has done for us in Jesus Christ. "I will offer up my life," 446 in the hymn. So let's start at the very end, a very unusual place to start. I'm going to put up the last two verses of the passage that that Claire read for us this morning on the screen. I just want to talk about them for a moment. John says, just verses 30 and 31. It's on the PowerPoint. If you're writing an academic paper or a thesis or something, early on you will be setting down your purpose or your aim for the investigation that you're reporting on. It's very important that the reader knows what it is you're looking for. And here in John's Gospel, but near the end of the Gospel, we have this very, very clear, concise, and challenging statement of purpose. He says, Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. And here's the purpose. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Everything written in the previous pages of his gospel has been carefully chosen and presented to support the claim that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and that by believing in him, the reader may find saving faith and eternal life in Christ. This faith, which we all hold dear, it's embodied in part in this gathering of people here today. This community of faith embodies that belief in part. And we are here to express our worship to God as a part of the outworking of that faith. And this faith that we hold is both evidential and experiential. And what I mean by that is this: that what we believe is expressed by John and his gospel and by other witnesses, and we believe the evidence of their recorded witness. And that recorded witness is supported by our own experience of the grace of God active in our lives. Just last night, some of us were we met for a meal. We meet quite regularly for a meal, and we always have a conversation over the meal. And last night, amongst other things, we discussed the importance of evidence in our faith. We can't sit down and prove to a non-believer that what we believe is true. We can't deliver that kind of mathematical proof. What we can do is we can set out reasonable grounds for our faith. In other words, we can show that what we believe, there is a good rational explanation for the things that we believe and for the experiences that we have. And that's so important for us to understand, that there is a clear rationale behind what we believe. John provides us, the Gospel of John provides us with some of that evidence. But he clearly says that there was much more that he didn't write down. In the next chapter, in fact, the very last verse of John's Gospel, he says, Jesus did many other things as well. If every one of them were written down, I suppose that not even the whole world would have room for the books that would be written. To illustrate that, it's clear from what John says that the unrecorded things that Jesus said and did far outweigh the recorded things that we know about. And to prove a point, if you like, just look at the Gospel of John. He covers just 20 days out of the 3.5 years of the ministry of Jesus in his 21 chapters. And 8 of those chapters deal with just 4 days between the Last Supper and the second Sunday of Easter. So you think, oh, wouldn't it be great to have all that extra stuff that he did and said that we don't have? Of course, it would be wonderful to see. But the key thing is, everything that needs to be said about God and his salvation and about Jesus has been said. There is enough there that we might believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing in him, we may have life in his name. There is enough evidence presented to us to allow us to come to a reasonable conclusion that he is well. But listen to this. This is what one commentator I read says about this. There is another reason why St. John selects the few signs and omits the many. Because, and here's the key, because Jesus is still alive and at work. Jesus Christ is a living person ascended to the right hand of God, reigning in the midst of the church. He, through his Spirit, is here ready to meet difficulties as they arise, ready to answer the questions suggested by his words, ready to lead his believers on in the path on which they have set out. All the Christian religion, he says, lies in that. It lies in the actual communion between the living soul and the living Christ. Not in reading about him, or hearing about him, or remembering the things he did, or even being convinced that he really did them. It begins and ends wholly in an active and energetic contact between the person of Jesus Christ and the person of his followers. What is written in this book leads us to a place where we can reach out and ask the Lord to come into our lives. Many, many testimonies that I have heard have at some point the person reaching a place of crisis, and in more in hope than in expectation, they cry out with words like, "Lord, if you're really there, please help me." And in that moment, there is something that changes in the spiritual world, in the spiritual realm, and they encounter Jesus in a real and living way. We see this in some of the characters we read about in the New Testament. We see this on Easter Sunday morning as Mary, her eyes bleary with tears, speaks to the gardener, and in the moment that he speaks her name, she believes. Also on the Easter Sunday morning, there is John who reaches the tomb, and he goes into the tomb, finds it empty, and he believes. And then there is this encounter with the disciples on that evening of the first Sunday of the week. They are met there behind locked doors because they were afraid, and suddenly he appears in their midst. They see him and they are overjoyed and they believe. And he breathes on them and says, "Receive the Holy Spirit." And thus in this moment began this new covenant relationship with the risen Christ by his Spirit. And he sends them out. He says, "I send you out just as the Father sent me, I'm sending you. I have a job for you to do. And it's not in here in this locked room, it's out there where the people are. Where the people are hungry and lost and broken. That's where I'm sending you." And this new life in them was going to be evidenced by how they continued to live their lives, inspired and filled with the Holy Spirit. But there was one of the disciples was missing that night. His name was Thomas, the twin. We don't know what happened to his brother or sister. He's never mentioned, so we don't know. We can only assume he wasn't a believer. But it doesn't matter. That was his name. But we know him, of course, by another name, Doubting Thomas. Thomas is... only appears in Matthew, Mark, and Luke in the lists of the disciples. And he comes like 7 or 8. So he's, and also ran in the Synoptic Gospels. But in John's Gospel, we read some stories that feature him. And we get a little glimpse of the character and the personality of this person we know as Thomas. John 11, as Jesus says he's going to go to Jerusalem because he heard that Lazarus was dying, and he was going to go to him. But they knew at this time that the clouds of opposition were beginning to gather in the skies, and they knew that there was danger in Jerusalem. And Thomas says, rather desperately, sure, let's all go too so that we can die with him. And it was that same Thomas who at the Last Supper, when Jesus said he's going to his Father, and you'll come too, I have a place prepared for you. And he says, but we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? Which leads Jesus to say one of his most famous phrases, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And then, of course, there are those famous words of doubt. As his 10 closest companions try to convince him that they've seen Jesus alive, that the things that Jesus said were true, he has risen from the grave. And he said, no, unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe. There is not enough evidence for me. How could he go through that whole week witnessing the joy, the relief, the awe of the disciples and the women who had also seen Jesus alive? How many times did, but Thomas, we've seen him, he's alive. And he said, nope, sorry, you're deluded, you're mistaken. I won't believe unless I see the wounds in his hands and feet. Was Thomas wrong to demand extra evidence, more evidence? How did he possibly overlook or ignore or discount the evidence of the changed lives of his companions? Was that not evidence enough? Thomas may have been slow to read the signs, but sure aren't we all? I think we can all very easily put ourselves in the place of Thomas. We have our doubts, we have our fears, we're not sure about things. We want to be more sure, we want to have more evidence. But at some point, the threshold of our evidence, the evidence we require, intersects with our spiritual need. And there comes a point when we are forced to our knees and we are forced to reach out to that little we know about him in the hope that he will respond to us. Like I said, you know, people in their testimonies, I've heard it many times from different people. Lord, I don't know if you're there. If you're real, Lord, I need you. The evidence of the written word has given them an understanding that there is a person called Jesus, and maybe, just maybe, he can do something for me. But I'm not sure. But in that moment of crisis, as we reach out to him and say, Lord, if you're really there, come into my life. I need you. I need you. And like Mary, as she heard her name in the garden, or like Thomas, who saw for himself the nail prints in his hands, we then, something changes within us and we encounter not the written word, but the risen Savior. We encounter the Spirit of God, and God's Spirit witnesses with our spirit that we are children of God. And that's the difference. That's the difference. And we become, in that moment, saved by grace through faith. The written evidence takes us to a point of vulnerability when we can reach out and say, Lord, I need you. And at that moment, God's Spirit just fills us anew. and we start afresh. Let's think a little bit more about Thomas. What happened to Thomas? Do you know, in that moment, as he fell to his knees and he cried out, "My Lord and my God," he was making two statements, both equally important. By crying out, "My God," he was recognizing that Jesus was himself divine. He was the God of all creation. And in saying, "My Lord," he was surrendering to him. And as we come to believe in Jesus, those are the two things that we need. We need to recognize who he is, and we need to surrender to him. And that is what we need to find salvation by faith. This is what happened to Thomas, and we may ask the question, what happened to him? Because we never read about him again. Well, he goes fishing with Peter a week or so later. But after that, and in the book of Acts, and in the letters of Paul, we never hear of Thomas again. But there is a very strong tradition that Thomas made his way to India. We've got some slides here to show you. It's no small walk. India, there you go. There's Google Maps. And if you put a pin in Jerusalem at one end and a pin in the place where he's believed to have first gone, to a place called Kerala in the very south of India, it's a distance of about 6,500 kilometers. So if he were to walk for like 4 hours a day, it would take him a full year to get there. It's believed that he arrived there about 20 years after the death and resurrection of Jesus. And I just wonder, how did that happen? I mean, did he hear a voice like Abraham, "Leave your home and your family and go to a place that I will show you"? Or did he just start walking from town to town? Did he ever return to Jerusalem? We just don't know. It's so frustrating. In fact, there is a tradition that he didn't walk, but he went via the Red Sea and took a very, very long and dangerous sea crossing. But it is believed that he established a community of believers in Kerala in the south of the country. And it is still active today, that community of Christians. And from there, he traveled east to modern-day Chennai, where it is believed that he was martyred and buried. Now, there are many who dispute these facts, and Aaron is the expert in this. I consulted with him yesterday about this, and it is disputed that this is real. And yet, there are so many pointers that suggest that it was real, that he did go there. One of the interesting bits of evidence is that there are Aramaic loan words in the local dialect that they speak around the south of India. And Thomas would have been speaking Aramaic when he arrived and would have had to learn the language. So there's an interesting pointer. But there are many more in that region today who look upon Thomas in much the same way as we look upon Patrick, as someone who had a profound impact upon the Christian heritage which we have inherited, we are part of. I contacted one of our Indian members, Jabrani. Jabrani is a Tamil from Tamil Nadu, very south of the country, where Kerala is situated. And oh, there you can see it there. That's those are the two churches on the right-hand side there. You can see one is, if you just go and look at the churches that have been built there. This is a church where it is believed he was over, where he was martyred. And the next slide shows where it is believed he was buried. And there are only three basilicas in the world that claim to be built over the remains of apostles. One in Rome, one in, I forget where the other one is, and this one in Chennai. But I spoke to Jabrani. I asked her, what does Thomas mean to you as someone who grew up in that region? She said this: "We as Indians are very privileged to have St. Thomas as a saint in our motherland. He brought Christianity through preaching the gospel. Thomas is a quite common surname. You can see the name Thomas in any Christian family. We are privileged to have many Christian schools and churches after his arrival to India. The faith and love you see towards St. Thomas in South India is incredible. I love that tradition. And I love that after a shaky start, Thomas embraced entirely the mission of Jesus to go out into the world and to make disciples. Thomas followed the evidence towards a personal faith in Jesus Christ. And Jesus changed his life so dramatically that he himself provided evidence for the generations that would follow him. And Gibrani is one of many who can trace their heritage, their Christian heritage, back through the centuries to this doubting Thomas. You know, believing in Jesus is only the beginning of our journey. And when we walk with him, we then become living witnesses. We then become evidence for those around us and those who will follow. And by our words, our actions, and our attitudes, many will be influenced to find their own faith in Jesus. And so, I guess I go back to what John said in the beginning of that, right at the start, those last two verses that Claire read for us. These things are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and by believing in him, you may have life in his name. So I ask you this morning, where is the evidence sitting with you this morning? Has it taken you to that place of saying, Lord, I have read about you, I've heard your stories, but now I must know you. I have to know you for myself. And for those of us who have made that step, are we living a life like Thomas that will lead to others encountering Jesus through the evidence that we provide in our lives? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the incredible human stories of people like Thomas and Peter and Mary and John that we learn so much from and who are such an inspiration to us. Lord, we thank you that your book isn't just a list of rules and regulations, but they tell real stories of real people who have real struggles and who come to the conclusion that you are God and you are good and you are present and you are with us. So, Lord, may we make that journey our own. May we encounter you in a personal way. And may we go from this place ready to walk with you and to live for you, that others may read in us the evidence that you are God, you are good, and you are present. Heavenly Father, we commit ourselves afresh to you, to the risen Lord Jesus Christ. Fill us again with your Holy Spirit and send us out, Lord, to be your witnesses, your disciples, your ambassadors. Father, we pray for our church. We pray for all in leadership in our church. We pray, Lord, that you will touch our hearts as a community and make us, fill us, Lord, with a real desire to be effective witnesses for you in our community and the communities where we live. Father, we pray particularly for any of our members who are unwell at this time, suffering from infirmity or advancing years. We pray for those who are separated from loved ones, either through circumstances or through geography. Lord, we know that you're the God of comfort. We know, too, that you are the God who reconciles and restores. Heavenly Father, we pray for those whom we may know who are not part of this community, but for whom we have a great deal of concern and care. And Father God, we pray for our world, a world where there is so much brokenness, so much need, where the peace of Christ is so desperately, desperately needed. Lord, may people around the globe today and tomorrow and in the days that follow, may they hear those words of Jesus, "Peace be with you. My peace I leave with you." So, Lord, we commit ourselves to your care and your keeping and to the mission that you've called us to. May we go from here filled with a newfound faith, satisfied that we have sure and certain grounds for faith, confirmed and realized through the presence of your Holy Spirit in us. We ask these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. And so to our closing hymn today. All I once held dear, built my life upon, number 489 in the hymn book. And after the service, there is prayer ministry. If anybody would like to have prayer or to respond to anything you've heard today, please do go and someone will pray with you. Let's stand to sing.
Fellowship with the Holy Spirit be with us all.